when we look at the book of Galatians, it's talking about a church in Galatia. Galatia is a particular province, an area in the Aegean Sea area, and they had a church there, and this was a group of people just like us. A group of people who believed in Jesus, who called upon his name, who wanted to do what's right, but they had been deceived. And Paul was writing to them to correct their deception so that the deception would come to an end. We sometimes need our eyes to be opened. It's what correction is about, to recognize, ooh, that's not the right way to act. And so it needs to change. So that's sort of the theme of Galatians to me as we talk about it. It, in some places, is a hard book to understand because the way the English translates the Greek, it's just in a way that we're not used to talking. So we're going to find a couple of those places, and it'll be good to spend a little time pounding through them for everybody. I believe everybody here has probably read the book of Galatians sometime in all of your Bible reading. You've read it, so it should be familiar to you. But we'll try to read it as if I'm the receiver of this letter from the Apostle Paul that's written to us. Take it that way. So Paul is writing. He's an apostle. He's not of men, neither by man. So he's not an apostle of men. He's not here really, in a sense, for men. He's the mouthpiece of God. He's an apostle. He's coming by the Spirit to do the work of the Spirit. And he's not by man. He's not of man, and he's not by man, because man did not make him an apostle. So this Holy Ghost, this Holy Spirit, this new life on the inside of him is what made him an apostle. And the calling of God and the direction of God, he becomes an apostle. But by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. How important is that? It's absolutely important. If there's no resurrection, we're yet in our sins. Always remember that. All the brethren which are with me, there was a bunch of people that traveled with Paul at different times, and he left in different places at different times. And all of them were writing unto the churches of Galatia. And I told you Galatia was not a particular city as much as it is a province. It's an area. Probably a number of towns and various things were involved. There might have been various congregations. He says to them, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I mean, it's these salutations. You can live in a Pauline salutation for quite a while because he tells you so much in here. But he's telling them that he wants to give them grace and peace that comes from God and from Jesus. That's amazing. And that here's what Jesus did for us. He gave himself for our sins to deliver us from this present evil world. People forget that. I'm not of this world. I was delivered from this world. I was set free from this world. That's what being born again does. That's what coming into the life of Christ Jesus does. You're taken out of the world. That's why Paul says, I'm not of men. He's out of the world. He's a spiritual being. Now, to whom the Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel. He gets right to it. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. He's just amazed at how quickly these people had gone and deviated off into something that was another story, not the story they'd been taught, which is not another, but there's some that trouble you and they pervert the good news of Christ. So this is not a new problem. It's been around for a long time. They take the gospel and they twist it. They wrestle with it. They pervert it. Understood? He says, though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. That's a pretty intense statement. He says, it's so important that you get this right that if somebody's preaching to you something different, they're cursed. That's intense. I don't want to be that one. As we said before, So say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that you have received, let him be accursed. He said it twice. Doesn't happen very often in his letters. He is making sure for emphasis they get it. This is extremely important. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I would not be the servant of Christ. Very important. I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men. I'm not delivering you the philosophies of a great thinker. I'm not delivering to you things that I spent years studying all of the great philosophers of time and came up with a compilation that really fits our experience in this world. He says, what I'm delivering to you came not from men. He's going to tell us it came from heaven. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's how he received it. When was Jesus revealed to Paul? If you know the story, he was on the road to Damascus with the purpose of putting in jail those that believed on Jesus. He believed at that time that they were Jewish heretics and they needed to be brought under control because their lies were spreading. And then he met Jesus on the road to Damascus. He fell down on his face. He said, Lord, who are you, basically? He just was blown away. He became born again. He began to see, and it was revealed to him what his purpose was in the earth, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But he had this experience. He says, I didn't receive this revelation because some man taught it to me, and I'm parroting to you what I was taught. I received something from heaven, something very real. This is why when you want to overcome the devil, one of the best ways to do it is the word of your testimony. It's the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. You have a testimony where you were brought out of darkness into his marvelous light. That testimony becomes the foundation that you are preaching. You're preaching what Jesus did. And then you can relate to it because you can say, this is what he did for me. And not only for me, but also for the whole world. He took my sin away, not only mine, but the sin of the whole world he took upon him, right? So this is what he's doing. He says, I didn't receive this. And what I'm attempting to do here is make sure you understand that this is not just for Paul. It's not just Paul that received this by revelation. You did too. If you will take heed to what happened to you, there was a conversion that occurred. Is there things you can learn and things that you can apply yourself to and places where the Holy Ghost can lead you and guide you and teach you? Yes, there are. But you also receive from God the same testimony that Christ Jesus came and changed you. If so be that you've been changed. If you've been made a brand new creature, right? So this, I want you to relate to that. Verse 13, for you heard of my conversation, my manner of living in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. I mean, those are big words. He really went after it. And I profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. He was into it. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. I did not go to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. And then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none except for James, the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God, I do not lie. Afterwards, I came into the regions of Syria and Cilicia and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preaches the faith which once he destroyed, and they glorified God in me. Excuse me. Then 14 years after, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me. So let's pause for a moment and think of this is the part of the history of Paul. What is he telling us? He had a revelation of Jesus when he got born again. Same as me. He immediately went to Arabia and then back to Damascus. We know the story. He was let down on a basket out of Damascus. He sought God. He knew the scripture from a very young child. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. From a young child, he memorized the old covenant, we call the Old Testament. He memorized the thing. And he knew the scriptures. And it's when he had the revelation of Jesus, suddenly the scriptures were opened to him. And the Holy Ghost revealed to him all the things that were there about Jesus that he had never known. That he had this great revelation of what Jesus had come and done for him. And he recognized it. And he didn't learn it from anybody else. He learned it from God and from the scripture. And then he came. Why did he come and see Peter and James, the Lord's brother? Because, as it tells us in other places, and I think later in here, he'll come in and he says, I submitted myself to them that seemed to be something. Because he recognized that submission to authority was so extremely important. But this is what we see in his life, the action of it. Not just the words of it, but the action of it. So now we're going to get right into the problem. Remember I told you he jumped right into it? I marvel that you're removed from another gospel. Now he's telling him, look, the gospel I preached to you was not something I just made up. Not something that was my opinion equal to other opinions. No, it was the revelation of Jesus. Okay? So I went up by revelation 2:1, 2:2, and communicated unto them that gospel which I preached among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. He says where he submitted himself to their authority. But neither Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. And this becomes an important part of what's the problem. So he's using it as an example, saying, look, nobody compelled Titus to be circumcised. And that, the only reason they even knew is because false brethren, unawares, brought in, who came in privily to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. They went to check him out. Is he circumcised? They snuck in to find out if he was circumcised. And then brought a charge against him, but he said Titus wasn't compelled to be circumcised. This is when he's in Jerusalem and he's before Peter and James, the Lord's brother. Nobody made Titus be circumcised then, and that becomes important later. He says in verse 5, to whom we gave place by subjection, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. He says, the gospel I preach must be pure. It must be the revelation of Christ Jesus, not the mind of man. It's extremely important that that be the case. So he makes it clear to them that, look, practically Titus was not forced to be circumcised. But of these who seem to be somewhat of all the leaders, who whatsoever they were, it makes no matter to me, God accepts no man's persons. That's big time. For they who seem to be somewhat in conference, they added nothing to me. They gave me nothing that I had not already received from God. But contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter, for he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. So he's saying, same Holy Ghost is going to lead you to the same conclusion. That's pretty intense. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. So their concentration was to the Jew. Paul was called to go to those outside, to the Gentiles. And the Jew is a very narrow little group. The Gentiles is everybody else. It's pretty intense. Only they would that we should remember the poor, the same that I was also given to do. I was really for that, then that's something important. The only thing that we talked about to add to what we were preaching was we need to remember the poor, take care of the poor. But when Peter was come to Antioch, now he's going to go into another story. He's making sure they understand, because circumcision is actually central to the problem these people are having. And you don't quite know that yet, but we're going to get there. They already knew that because they were living in the church where they were dealing with this issue. So they already knew the issue, but he's going to get to it later, and we'll wait on him. But notice what he's done. He's told us, I received this from God. It was confirmed by those that seemed to be somewhat that were ministering to them. And Titus, who was with me when we came up to submit our way, was not compelled to be circumcised. Now Peter comes to Antioch, and I withstood him to the face. That would have been something to see. Could you imagine being in that room or around there when Paul and Peter are having it out and Paul's in his face? That would be intense. I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. He needed correcting. That's, wow. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. When he was there at Antioch, he was eating with the Gentiles, which remember, under the law, Jews were not allowed to do. Who was it that first received the message that it was okay to preach the Gentiles? Peter. God gave him a dream multiple times saying, look, rise, kill and eat. Oh, I've never touched that which is unclean. What God has made clean, don't call unclean. And then he sends them to the Gentiles. And he preaches and they receive the Holy Ghost. And I go, who are we to restrict baptism from them that had received the Holy Ghost? And it goes on. You know the story, I hope. So he says, but he ate with the Gentiles because there's no, what God had made clean, you don't call unclean. But then certain Jews from James came, and when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them that were of the circumcision. He thought, maybe I could just, I won't eat with the Gentiles right now because I just don't want to deal with these guys. Who knows what he thought? But he withdrew himself from fellowshipping with the Gentiles, and so Paul got in his face. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. I mean, Paul's going, he was like the only guy left who was saying, you guys aren't walking right. He had to get in all their faces. This is amazing. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, that's why I was saying it would have been something to be in the room, because there's the whole group. It's like we're all here, and I'm going to get in Christopher's face, and I'm going to tell Christopher, can get in my face or something, and you're going to all have to witness it. Wow, that's intense. He says, I got in there before them all and said, if you, being a Jew, live after the manner of Gentiles and not as do the Jews, why do you compel the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? What are you doing, man? We are not, as we're going to find out, we're not under that old law any longer. We don't do the Jewish ritual law any longer. And we're going to find that out. We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles. So what's he talking about? I was born into the right group. Jews were the only group that could interact with God in the right way. It says we that were Jews by nature and we weren't sinners by nature like the Gentiles. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Nobody could be just before God by trying to keep the law. It was impossible. Everybody had to have a redeemer. This is why in 1 John it's so important. When they make the statement, any man who says he has no sin, it's talking about the fact that anybody who says, I stand perfect and have no need of redeemer, is a liar. Every single one of us and everybody we've ever known needs Jesus to redeem them. Okay? Jew or Gentile, law keeper or not, didn't matter. So no flesh shall be justified by the works of the law. Verse 17, but if, while we seek to be justified by Christ, we also ourselves are found sinners, is Christ therefore the minister of sin? God forbid. Remember the God forbids from Romans, when we did Romans? It's like over and over. Same Paul. he uses this device where he comes and says, okay, so if I've been made righteous by Christ Jesus, if I'm justified by Christ, and then I'm found a sinner, is therefore Christ the minister of sin? No way. God forbid. That is never the conclusion to come to. For if I build again the things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. Got that? What I do. See, I can get justified by Christ, made righteous, but if I go back to the weak and beggarly elements of the world and go back to doing the things that I was saved from, I'm the one who rebuilds that which it was destroyed, I destroyed. And so he's telling us very clearly that justification in Christ Jesus has nothing to do with keeping the law. But if I go back and put myself in a compromised situation, then it's my fault. I did that. Okay? It wasn't Christ that did that. For verse 19, for I through the law am dead to the law that I might live unto God. That's our life. Our life is in him. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I've been raised from the dead. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. My life's in him. I have no life but his. I have nothing but what he gave me. Everything that I had has been burned up and destroyed. Everything that was gained to me in this world has been repudiated and left aside. So he's teaching them that gospel that he received from heaven. He's saying it to them again, and he's preaching it to them again, that they might hear it clearly. Verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. So what's the issue? As we stop at the end of chapter 2, what's the issue? These Judaizers, as we sometimes call them, had come in to these Gentile Christians and said, hey, in order to be righteous, you need to keep the law. You need to do these things, and you need to be circumcised, and you need to, you know, follow these various rules. Because it's good for you to do it our way, right? It's like we do it the same many times today even, where people say, oh, it's the reason these existed, God did these things. I've said this before here, but I've done lots of circumcisions. None of you have probably ever done one, right? I have performed the procedure many times. And when I do it, I often will talk about circumcision of the heart with whoever's in the room, you know, because oftentimes people want to be there. So we'll do the procedure, and I will talk about circumcision of the heart. And people will say, well, it's cleaner, and it's this, it's that. Nonsense. All it is it's a testimony that the body of the sins of the flesh has been removed, and you've been brought into fellowship with God. Your heart is now open to relate to God, and you don't have to be a boy to have one. You can have your heart circumcised no matter who you are, and it's just a testimony of that. That's it. So if somebody comes and says, well, you know, it'd be better to be circumcised. No, it's not. Not better. It means nothing. Zippo. Doesn't have anything to do with what we are in Christ Jesus. Right? So, chapter 3. Now that he's laid out the issue, O foolish Galatians. We're back to the I marvel that you're so soon removed. Who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Which one was it? Hearing of faith. You heard the word and you received. You heard the word and you believed. You believed and you were changed, all by that which Jesus did. Not by what you did, not by how you earned it, not by becoming a member of the club and getting through all the rituals that needed to be done, not by learning your catechism and repeating it correctly. I mean, none of that got you saved. We got saved when we heard the good news and it was Jesus was revealed to us and we said, yes, Lord, I believe. And you were changed. That's my testimony. I heard the word of God and I was attracted to it. I heard the good news of the gospel and I said, I want that. And I cried out to God and he came and saved me in his mercy and in his grace. I didn't earn it. I didn't attain to it. I didn't get a higher grade on the test than everybody else, and that's why I got it. Had nothing to do with it, right? Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Hearing of faith. Are you so foolish? If you've begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Now that you've received the newness of life in Christ Jesus, are you made perfect by keeping the law? No. I've experienced this in my own life where there were times when I sat down and I began to think, well, Lord, it's so good that you've done all this for me, but now I got to get these things right. That's wrong. Absolutely wrong. Does that mean that I don't have to do things right? No. I go to him. Lord, change me. Lord, fill me. Lord, strengthen me. Lord, teach me. Holy Spirit, lead me, guide me, bring me into all the truth. Show me your way. If I lean on my own strength to do it, it's wrong. Okay, so I'm a Gentile. I got saved, and people come to me and say, you know, your life would be a whole lot better if you do things the way we do them. Your life would be so much better. And here, let me show you. Do this, do this. In fact, let's get you all circumcised because it'll be better for you. And I'm adding to what Christ Jesus did for me. That's why Paul is so vociferously against it, because he says that this stuff that seems innocuous, it doesn't seem that important. So what's they got circumcised? What difference does it make? But when you're putting your trust in anything other than Jesus, you're wrong. And it's going to create problems in your life. That's what this book is about. So let's keep going, because we got a lot of letter to read here. Verse 4, have you suffered so many things in vain? If it be yet in vain. He therefore that ministers to you the Spirit and works miracles among you, does he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? The hearing of faith. Even as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. That was it. Where did he get his righteousness? He believed God. That's it. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. It's one of the most important scriptures that tells us that from that time, clearly God intended to save everybody. He intended to give the opportunity to everybody, not just to the Jew. Okay? Not even just to the seed of Abraham in any way. But to everybody. He says, in thee all nations shall be blessed. So then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. You have the same faith, him, you believe God, you're blessed with faithful Abraham. You receive the righteousness of God by faith. That's intense. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. All things. So if you're going to say, well, circumcision is a good one, we'll bring that in. Everybody here that's in Jesus needs to be circumcised. Now you're a debtor to do the whole thing. So let's get our calves and our goats and our bullocks. Let's get our priestly garments and let's get a high priest and let's get an altar built. You're a debtor to do the whole thing. If any part of it becomes a part of what makes you acceptable in Christ Jesus, then you have to do the whole thing. Because cursed is everyone that continues not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident. For the just shall live by faith. Habakkuk chapter 2, 4. We talked about that a bit when we did Romans. And the law is not of faith, but the man that does them shall live in them. Now we talk a lot about Jesus saying, you got to hear my word and do it, right? He does say that to us. But our righteousness came by believing on him. When Pastor Mark talks to us about confessing a good confession of who he's made us, it's all the things that the Bible tells us that we've received by faith. I received the righteousness of Christ Jesus by faith. He's made me holy. I am righteous, for he is righteous. I'm holy, for he is holy. Because he made me. He commanded me to be this. He made me that. These are all the things he did for us. What do I then do? I learn to submit and trust him. I learned to obey him. Do what he said. He told me to go. And the biggest problem we have is that we sit and do not go. Because when we go, we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. If I'm not given the word of my testimony, then I have a problem. One of the greatest things I ever discovered was that, you know, when people would ask a question and you could just immediately turn the conversation and say, you know, let me tell you, my perspective has changed in my life because when I was 16 years old, I got radically born again, and I can't think any other way, that nothing works other than by that. There's no other way to be delivered from all this depression except for what he did for me. He changed me. He made me righteous. He made me holy. I mean, it's a great, you know, testimony. It's a testimony. This is what Jesus did for me. Would you like him to do that for you? You don't even have to ask him. In fact, I'll pray for you and he'll do it for you. You know, these kind of things, if you would just believe. So, verse 12, the law is not of faith, but the man that does them shall live in them. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, but he made a curse for it. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Is it important to receive the promise of the Spirit? Yes. The whole point of being born again was so you could receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus said to you, it's good to you that I go away, because if I don't go away, the Holy Ghost cannot come to you. But if I go away, we will send him unto you. And it's a wonderful thing. We got to have it. We must live in it. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men, though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it is confirmed, no man disannuls it or adds thereto. If we sit down and make a contract with one another, you can't just walk in unilaterally and change it. We made a contract with one another. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. Abraham and his seed. He didn't say to seeds as of many. He didn't say to Abraham and to his seeds, but as of one, to the Abraham's seed, which is Christ, to thy seed, which is Christ. When God said, in your seed shall all the nations be blessed, he was talking about Christ Jesus. Now, could the Jew have walked in the things that God gave them and fulfilled the blessing of people around them? They did, many times. History books won't understand this, but there was a period of time, especially in David and Solomon's kingdom, when they were affecting everybody around them greatly. But it's all been lost in the mishmash of history and people trying to discount the word of God. They had great blessing to all the nations around about them. Believe me, taking all the giants out was a big deal. All the people were rejoicing. When the giants were gone under David, everybody's happy about that. Then when anybody was unhappy about that. Okay? So they were blessing people around them just by doing that. So, to Abraham and to his seed, to thy seed which is Christ. So this is the promise. It's to Jesus. Through Abraham, it's to that seed. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which comes 430 years later, cannot disannul to make that promise of no effect. The promise to Abraham that in his seed, singular, all the nations will be blessed, could not be made different because the law entered in. The law comes later, and we're going to learn why the law came. For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Wherefore then serve the law? Here's that type of question, that rhetorical question. Well, what's the law for? If the law has nothing to do with what happened to Abraham, what's it for? It was added. It was added for a particular reason, because of transgressions. Till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. Who's that? Jesus. The law was added because of the transgressions of the people of Abraham until the seed to who the promise was made should come. So when God said to Abraham, in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, he was speaking also to that one we call the Word of God. You're going to come and you're going to be the Redeemer. This is going on, right? And it was ordained by angels in the hands of a mediator. This is the law now. We're going to now contrast the law from the promise. This is where it gets, I mentioned earlier to some of the people here right at the beginning, this is where it gets a little bit tough because the English and the Greek don't quite match up, and it's really hard words. So I'm going to try very hard to help you to understand this. Now, a mediator is not of one, but God is one. Now, in the King James, it's got a mediator in italics. It's not there in the literal. So if you read this, it's now a mediator is not of one, but God is one. The mediator that's standing there is not the one who makes the covenant with the seed. Okay? But God is the one who made that covenant. One God. Right? He's one. Is the law then against the promise of God? Notice that we're on that same subject. Is the law against the promise of God? God forbid. Get a second one of those in here. For if there had been a law given, which could have given life, truly, righteousness would have been by the law, or as we might say to define it, the law of Moses. It would have been by that law that God gave to Moses. It was the most perfect law ever given. I believe very firmly in history, Hammurabi comes after Moses. He copied Moses' law code. Why? Because the blessing of God upon the Jew, they began to see it and they began to adopt it. It's very, very important. Secular history tell you it was the other way around. It's nonsense. The important thing about this is this law is, it's the perfect law. It stands and declares to us the difference between sin and righteousness very clearly. It points the sin out. Who points sin out today? Is it the law? It's the Holy Ghost. He comes to convince you of sin, comes to convince the world of sin. Why? Because he wants to make you feel bad? No, because he wants to call you up out of where you find yourself, right? So, it's very important that we understand. Where then, verse 19, wherefore then serves the law? It was added because of transgressions until Jesus, I'm just going to put that in there, should come, because he's the one the promise was made to, and it was ordained, the law was ordained by angels in the hands of a mediator. A mediator is not of one, God is one. Understand, the mediator is not God. That mediator that was set there, he brought something that's an addition to the promise that God had made. And that's what I want you to understand there. Is the law then against the promise of God? God forbid, because this is a perfect law, as we said. Verse 22, the scripture has concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. That's intense. The law concluded. It showed everybody, you're all under sin. It made it so clear. Why? So you'd recognize your need for the one, the Redeemer, the seed, who is Jesus Christ. You need him. You got to have him. All the people that don't have him, they're dead. They may look like they're alive, they're dead. You must have Jesus. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Under the law, this faith was not revealed. Were there some who knew it? I believe there were. There were some who recognized it, but they saw in part. They prophesied in part. It was like they saw it, but it was just kind of just too far away to reach. They saw it. But we were kept under the law until the day when the seed to whom the promise was made would be revealed, Christ Jesus. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith has come, it's very important, we are no longer under schoolmaster. No longer. You no longer need the law to teach you. Who teaches you now? The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. He teaches you now. See, because this came so that the Spirit, we might receive, verse 14 of that chapter, verse 3, that you might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. That's so important because now you don't need the law to convince you of sin. You don't need the law to be your schoolmaster. You have the Holy Ghost. That's amazing. This is why you have to build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God, right? Yeah. This is what we do. It's powerful. But after the faith has come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster, for you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. That's it. You believe on him, you call on his name, he'll make you a child. For as many as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. His life is now yours. There is neither Jew nor Greek, nor bond nor free. There's neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you be Christ's, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. See, if you belong to Christ Jesus, if you are in him and he is in you, then you receive all the promises that the seed was there. So what is your purpose on the earth? That all the nations of the earth would be blessed. That's why we're here. What did Jesus do? He went about doing good, healing all those who were oppressed of the devil, right? So he did. That's what we're called to be. We're called to be him, we're called to be like him. Not just like him, we are called to be him, the manifestation of Christ Jesus on the earth. Chapter 4. Now I say, he's going to talk about this other issue, that the heir, as long as he's a child, differs nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. Now, I commented that some of these things are hard to understand. Pastor Mark has made a very big emphasis on chapter 4 of understanding certain things that I will tell you honestly, when he first talked about them, I was a little bit, I'm not sure why that's important. Honestly, I mean, I just, not out of rebellious thought, not out of disagreement, just out of, well, he's saying it, it's by the Holy Ghost, I hear it, but I wasn't sure I understood why it's important. But I laid it before the Lord, said, Father, show me. Show me why this is important. And he preached it many times. We're going to see this here. But I want you to just sort of follow on the language so that you understand what this is said. This is that other place. An heir, as long as he's a child, differs nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. So we all understand how that works, right? You're growing up. You got tutors and governors and teachers and people that lead you and mentor you until you reach the age when you can take it all on yourself. And remember, we concluded at the end of chapter 3 that we're heirs according to the promise. So we got that far, but he's going to take us further. That's the whole point here. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. Notice this. When we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. Is that the testimony of somebody who's been born again? No, it is not. But it is often what we do with these things is we begin to think, okay, I've been born again and now I'm under this bondage in the world and I'm waiting for something to come. Okay? I want to emphasize to you that being in bondage under the elements of the world is not the born again experience. Just like Romans 7 is not the born again experience, right? But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. What's the fullness of time? The time when the child no longer needs to be under tutors and governors. Okay? Understand that. When the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. That was Jesus. To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption or the becoming truly his sons. And this is where Pastor Mark has emphasized that the word adoption here is made a son. It's not truly adoption. Now, you know, I used to think, well, I mean, adoption. I know people who've adopted kids and they love them like their own and they're fully a child and they receive the inheritance. And so does it really matter? It does matter. It matters from this point to make very clear that the tutors and governors part is what we were like under the law that God gave to Moses. That law, it was tutors and governors time. We had a law trying to be their schoolmaster. We had a law trying to teach us. We had a law trying to show us that our need for God, right? But we have now been made sons because we're in Christ Jesus. This isn't about your particular story in the sense of what happened in your lifetime and the years that you've lived. This is about the story of the people who call upon the name of the Lord and where they were found under tutors and governors until the time when the seed, which had been given the promise, should come and redeem those of us and make us sons. fully matured sons. You hear the difference? It took me a long time. I heard Pastor Mark preach it numerous times before laying before God. I went, oh, Lord, your revelation. Because it's just a little, when you've been taught things wrong, or you've thought things wrong for a long time, it's hard to overcome your own thinking, because you think that you're really special and that you understand so much. I mean, we all do this, okay? To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption, or the being made a son. All of you girls made a son too, okay? And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. This is not babyhood. This is relationship. You've now been brought into the relationship of a son through Christ Jesus. Wherefore, you are no more a servant, but a son. And if you're a son, then you're an heir of God through Christ. Howbeit then, when you did not know God, when you knew not God, you did service unto them which by nature are no gods. You serve the gods of this world. But now, after that you've known God, or rather are known of God, how turn you again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto you desire again to be in bondage? I marvel that you're so soon removed. Why have you turned back to tutors and governors? Why have you turned back to trying to keep the law by trying to meet up to some artificial earthly code? What's going on with you? You've missed it somewhere along the way. You observe days and months and times and years. This is all the things that they had. You know, you got to be this feast, we all got to come up, and this one, we got to do this, and then you got to offer this sacrifice. I mean, just all this stuff. All of which, it had something useful. It pointed us to Jesus. But we're not under that anymore. I'm afraid of you, he says. I'm afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Remember earlier he said, if it be yet in vain? Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as you are. You've not injured me at all. You're not hurt. It's just, I'm not doing this because you hurt me. I'm not doing this because I want you to believe me. There's no self need in this for Paul. But out of the love of Christ, he's beseeching them. Verse 13, you know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first, when I first came. My temptation, which is in my flesh, you did not despise it nor reject it, but you received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness you spoke of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you'd have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? He's telling them the truth. Why? Because as he made clear in the early chapters, this is extremely important. This is not a minor issue. This is not something that's, well, you know, it's okay. They can do that over there. It's not okay, because you take away from the faith that is in Christ Jesus. Right? Where was I? Verse 16. Am I therefore your enemy because I tell you the truth? They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that you might affect them. Whoa, what's he saying? He's saying they want to bring you under bondage that you might make them feel good about what they go and teach, and that you might exalt them for being smart enough to tell you what the things that you need to do. In other words, bring you back under the bondage of tutors and governors that are there for the time where we wait for the Son to be revealed. The young child who's growing, we're waiting for the Son to be revealed. When was the Son revealed? Christ Jesus was the Son who was revealed. He was made under law. He was the coming seed. He was the Redeemer of men. He was the seed of the woman, as well as the seed of Abraham. He was all of these things. And he came and he fulfilled this work. He did that. I didn't do that. It's not about my time of existence on this earth that fulfills that. It's what he did, right? And it's extremely important. Where is then the blessedness that you spake of? Oh, that's right. I read that already. They zealously affect you. Verse 18. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again. In other words, if it be yet in vain, is there any hope that I can travail to bring you to birth again? Wow, they had to be born again. That's intense. That'll mess up some people's doctrine. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again, until Christ be formed in you. I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, because I stand in doubt of you. Wow, that's like, I'm concerned you're not even saved. You're not even right with God. You're on your way to hell. I'm going to put it simple. I stand in doubt of you. Tell me, you that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written. And now he's going to do an allegory. So you got to stay with what the point is. Sometimes when you go into these allegories, you get lost. So let's remember the point. The point is, he's trying to illustrate for us the difference between the tutors and governors of the law and that which is by the faith of Christ Jesus and by the Spirit. That's the dichotomy here. Okay? It is written, Abraham had two sons, one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants. They're teaching you about the two covenants. The one from the Mount Sinai, which leads genders to bondage, which is Hagar, or Agar in this case. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and answers to Jerusalem, which now is and is in bondage with her children. What's he talking about? The Jerusalem on the earth, earthly Jerusalem at the time that Paul's writing this, is under the Romans. Okay? It's in bondage. And many people wanted it to be relieved of the bondage of the Roman Empire so that it could be delivered and that they could rise up and be all the things that the law told them to be. But that wasn't it. Jesus came to die, right? Rose from the dead and gave us a kingdom that's not of this world. But Jerusalem, which is above, what Jerusalem is that? Mount Zion in the sides of the north, the city of the great king, the heavenly Jerusalem, right? Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not, for the desolate hath many more children than she which has a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. So who's we talking about? Who's the first person that fulfills that? It's Sarah. She's barren her whole life. But yet what's testified of her? She believed God enough to call her husband Lord and to follow him and do everything he told her to do and support him in everything that God told him to do. That's an incredible testimony. She was willing to do that. She was barren, though, and the reproach upon her in their society was great. Many people would have said of her, well, they're judged of God. That's why she has no child. That's why she was so desperate for a child, she got her handmaid to go into her husband so that she could get pregnant, so there'd be a child in the house, because she's trying to take away the reproach. But guess what? It becomes in and of itself a reproach. But we're going to hear that. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of the promise. We've been redeemed by faith in Christ Jesus, the faith of Christ Jesus. We've been redeemed. We've been made of the Spirit, not under the law, not under earthly things. We've been made and redeemed by the Spirit. But as then, he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the Spirit. Even so it is now. That's the way it is. Those that say, I'm going to walk in the Spirit, will be persecuted by those that want to walk in the flesh. And this is what is really, truly meant when you hear Pastor Mark talk about religion. You know, it's a tough word because, you know, it all depends. There is a true religion undefiled, is keep yourself unspotted from the world, visit the widows and the fatherless. I mean, in that context, it's not a bad word. But what are we talking about? We're talking about this. It's talking about kept under the law because now you are trying to be made perfect by those things that you do. I got born again when I was 16 and I've spent the last however many years trying to be perfected in God. No. Wrong. It is very important that we understand that is not what we're about. Yes, there's maturing. Yes, there's growing in the call and the things God wants us to do. That's not what we're talking about. I was made a son. I was brought into life in Christ Jesus and made a son. No longer under tutors and governors. No longer in a situation that we had to do it. We raise up our children and we try to teach them things to, you know, look, don't touch the hot stove. It's going to burn you. Hey, you don't play with knives. Somebody's going to get cut. We try to teach our children not to do crazy things. But when I've been born from above and I've been filled with the Spirit, my teacher is now the Holy Ghost. And he will lead me and guide me into all the truth. Nevertheless, verse 30, what says the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. And he tells us very clearly, that is an allegory to teach us about the difference between the covenant of the law. Was the law sin? God forbid. God forbid. The law was perfect, but it had no power to change the heart of those that kept it. Had no power to make us brand new. Christ Jesus' power make us brand new, right? We are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. That's who we are. That's who I am. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and don't be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. What yoke of bondage? Well, you know, let me add a little bit to help you out, Christopher. I know that you've been born again, but I'm going to show you some things that's going to make your life better in God. I'm going to show you some things that God will be pleased with. Let me help shape you a little bit. That's evil. I should never do that. Never, ever, ever do I need to touch the altar of God, the temple of God, and shape it with my hands. What's going to shape you? It's going to be the Holy Ghost. If there's going to be any shaping done, it's going to be the Holy Ghost. If there's going to be any convincing of sin, it's going to be the Holy Ghost. So when, why does the preacher preach? Because he's the mouthpiece of God, speaking by the Holy Spirit to say those things that need to be said, that your heart would be pricked and touched, that you might call upon him and repent and be changed. I mean, that's what it's all about. It's not about me sitting down and coming up with a little manual that's going to explain to you all the things that we do at the abiding place and that they don't do other, you know, that we don't do these things, and then that's going to be your righteousness. Because that just leads to problems that we can see even in the natural. We can understand how that leads to problems. But it's really a problem in the spirit, because I should never do any of those things. Do not. Got it? So you getting this?
Yes.
Everybody's following? This is big time stuff. Verse 2, behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if you be circumcised, Christ profits you nothing. Does that mean if your parents had you circumcised and you're a little boy, you're in trouble? No, it's if you're trusting in any way, shape, or form that circumcision brings you into something that's positive in God. It's not in God, it's in the flesh. Has nothing to do with that. He's saying that if you're going to add anything to what Christ Jesus has done for you, then Christ Jesus profits you nothing. That's why he's so passionate about this. So many people have been taught to add unto what God and Christ Jesus has done for them that it has now put them into bondage to the law, and they don't even realize it. They think they're children of the free woman, but they're serving under as children of the bondwoman. And calling it Christ Jesus in the earth. It's not. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, he's debtor to do the whole law. Look, if you're going to trust in anything that you do, you're debtor to do the whole thing. Don't leave any part of it out. Christ has become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law, for you're fallen from grace. That's as clear as it can be. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision avails anything nor uncircumcision, but faith, which works by love. It's all out of relationship. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? This persuasion comes not of him that calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubles you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. He's pleading with them again. Remember, he's gone through his allegories and his various things, but he's back to the same pleading. He started off, I marvel that you're so soon removed. He's pleading with them, come back. Come back. He says, you did run well. Who hindered you? You ran well, but who hindered you? What got in your way that you did not obey the truth? Right? So, verse 11, I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross cease. I would they were even cut off which trouble you. For, brethren, you've been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. It's why the whole law is contained in this. Love the Lord thy God with all the heart, all the mind, all the soul, and all the strength. And the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Right? I mean, this is what we're supposed to do. Love one another and serve one another. That will fulfill the whole law. The whole law will be fulfilled in that. You just do that by the Spirit. As Pastor Marcus said many times here, you know, you hear these things. Sometimes he says them over and over and again. They work in you. Because it's by the Spirit. And he says, I've asked God to make it so that I fall in love with people within, 3 to 5 seconds after I meet them. What's he doing? Is he going, I'm going to show you guys how to love people in 3 to 5 seconds in 5 easy steps. Follow after me, do what I do and everything. No, he said, what he's showing you is, I see the need I have to fall in love with people, so I'm asking the Lord, make in me and put within me the ability to love people in 3 to 5 seconds. That's how you change. When you're convinced of sin, I did for many years, I always heard it as, I got more work to do. And I go to work because I would try to bring everything, every bit of strength, every bit of mental intelligence, everything I had, I tried to bring it to bear so that I could get this thing right. And I'd end up in the same place because it will do nothing for you. But if you recognize your need and you will call upon this one who saved you and you will allow him to perfect you the same way that he changed you in the first place, by the Spirit, by the hearing of faith, it'll happen just like that. And you'll wonder how it happened. Is it even possible that it could happen like that? Yeah, that's how you got born again. It just happened like that. I believe it's a lot harder for people who grew up thinking they got saved when they were 2. You know, I think it's a little harder. I at least have a place, and I think all of you do have a place, and if you were raised in church and grew up in it, I mean, it's a place where you can point to the time when you died, when you recognized that you no longer wanted to live your old life and you took a new one. But once you've taken that new one, you want to live in that new one, not go pick up the old one again. Okay? And that's what we do. That's why Paul's saying, because we've been made brand new, and then he says, put off the old man. You think, well, I thought the old man was already cut away and destroyed. Yeah, but you keep picking it up. So put that off and put on the new one. Choose to say, I'm going to walk in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Because you can still go back and pick the thing up. You can go back to the weak and the beggarly elements, the tutors and governors of this world, and the working of the earthly mind and things. You can go back to that. But what does Paul say? You're fallen from grace when you do that. That's scary. And I believe that this is most people that I have known that are in the church do this to some degree or another without even knowing that's what they're doing. Because there's nobody preaching by the Holy Ghost. They're preaching by men's philosophies. They're sitting down and crafting words and putting together a sermon with great illustrations and designing something that's pleasing to the ears of men instead of just speaking the Word of God and letting the Word of God have its effect. That's what's happening. This is who we are supposed to be. Those who go in Christ Jesus by the Spirit and speak the Word of God so that it will have the effect it was meant to have. Not the effect we try to craft in our own ability, which is what we do. The church is so full of it that its leaders, this is why he says, those that trouble you, verse 10, shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. Whoa, that's intense. I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be that guy. Is he going to stand before God in his own ability? And it's, no. Uh-uh. I'm standing in Christ Jesus. Correct me now, O Lord. Do it now. Verse 13 again. For brethren, you've not been called into liberty. You've been called into liberty, only use not liberty for an occasion of the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one of another. What is bite and devour one another? That's we talked when we were doing James, how we judge people according to our knowledge in the flesh. We judge things according to what our perceptions are, what we believe is right. Are you a Republican or Democrat? Do you vote the way I vote? Whatever it might be. Do you look like me? Do you act like me? Do you follow my set of rules? We judge like that. And he's telling us right here, you bite and devour one another, constantly judging one another. Bad. This I say then, this is great. Walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. It's that simple. It's walk in the Spirit. By love, serve one another. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. What does that sound like? That's Romans 7 in one verse. Isn't it? When you're in that back and forth, in the flesh, in the Spirit, in the flesh, in the Spirit, war in between the two, you cannot do the things you want to do. But if you be led of the Spirit, then you're not under the law. You're not in the flesh. You're not in that way. You just got to be led of the Spirit. Well, how do you get led of the Spirit? He gives the Holy Ghost to who? Those that ask him. Just ask. That's why I use the illustration. Pastor Mark telling us, I asked the Lord, Lord, I want to love people in 3 to 5 seconds after I meet them. He didn't say, Lord, I'm going to show you how good I am. I'm going to figure out a way to love people in 3 to 5 seconds. He said, Lord, I see the need to love people. Lord, come, I need you to help me to love people in 3 to 5 seconds. Do you see the difference? That it's so clear in the Word of God, but yet people have not heard it or understood it. Now the works of the flesh are manifest. They're these. There are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I've also told you in time past, that they which do such things, they will not inherit the kingdom of God. We're not talking about I'm free to do those things. It's very important. That's not what we're saying. We're saying you're free to love people. You're free to serve people. You're free to walk in the Spirit. That's what you're free to do. That's it, okay? But the fruit of the Spirit, when you walk in the Spirit, it's love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there's no law. There's no law against these things. You can do all of the joy you want to do, okay? But you can't do all the sorrow that you want to do, okay? And they that are Christ's, they've crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Let's not be those people. So what happens if I notice in my life, if I notice in my life that there's something that's like envy, we'll take this because it uses this example. There's envy. I'm envious of you. You have something that I don't have, and I wish that I had it. And so I envy you, and I'm upset that you have it and I don't have it. So maybe I'll be like Simon the sorcerer, and I'll offer you money. Jeremy, can I give you money so that you'll give me the power to lay my hands on people and they receive the Spirit? I mean, where am I? I'm in the gall of bitterness. Why? Because I'm looking in the flesh, and I'm judging after the flesh, and I'm hoping to obtain by something that I have. Jeremy, can you teach me because I'm smart enough to learn? Can you give it to me because I have enough money to buy it? That's envying. What if I recognize in myself, or I'm Simon and Peter tells me flat out, you have no part in this work. You are in the gall of bitterness. What should I do? Repent. Oh God, thank you, Holy Ghost, for showing me my need. Father, help me. Cause me to love and not to envy. That's what you do. That's the proper response. But our response has so often been, they don't like me. It really has. Many, many times. He's upset with me. He thinks I'm a loser, so I must be one. Do you understand how this all is telling us this? It's telling us right here, let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another, because we're supposed to be loving one another. But he's already just spent the whole last couple of chapters telling us, how do we get walk in the Spirit? You ask, you call, you reach, you say, Lord, I began in the Spirit by believing you. That's how I began. I'm going to be made perfect the same way, right? I'm going to put off the old man with his deeds because I'm going to stop picking him up again. I'm going to stop going back to the weak and the beggarly elements. I'm going to stop going back to the judgments of my mind. Stop going back to the ability of my flesh. I'm going to stop. I'm not going to do that anymore. How? Lord, I need to not be picking that old thing up anymore. Come help me. That's simply that. He'll do it. Because everything I have is what he does for me, not what I do for him. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which walk in the Spirit, you which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. So I'm going to use Christopher again, because he's right here. I see Christopher in a fault. He's telling everybody that they need to, you know, be circumcised. I see him in a fault. So in the spirit of meekness and lowliness, I go to him to restore him. But I got to be careful that I don't fall in that same thing where I'm saying, Christopher, let me help you show you how to do this right. Because now I'm going to shape Christopher like he's been trying to shape everybody else. That's the temptation I have to avoid. I can't do that. If I see him in a fault, I have to, by the Spirit, speak to him the Word of God, and the Holy Ghost take care of the rest of it. But if I go and try to, look, let me show you this. Christopher, you're too much lasciviousness in your life. You need to stop dancing. If you don't dance, then you won't have so much lasciviousness. So I think it would be good if none of us danced, because then there will be no lasciviousness. This is a real example. This is the kind of things that churches would do. And they would give you things that you're not supposed to do, because why? They meant well. They were trying to help. They said, look, if you don't go to the bar, you won't have so much trouble drinking so much alcohol. Good. But if I make a rule that you're only in Christ if you don't go to the bar, well, I missed it. Yes, drunkenness, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. But that doesn't mean I can't go to the bar. What if I go there to preach the gospel? But if I make a rule that you can't go to the bar and that you're bad because you did, then what I've done is I've added to the Word of God, and I've made a place for you to stumble, and then you come to me and go, well, you know, that not dancing thing just really isn't right. There's nothing wrong with dancing, Christopher. Why are you doing that? Well, that's what I was told. My friend came to me and told me. What I'm trying to help you understand is you have to be careful that when we restore such a one, it's not for me to go and tell you how you need to wear your hair and how you need to dress. The Holy Ghost is going to lead you and guide you. And he's going to teach you how to do it, right? And it's been good. And you're zealously affected many times when they said, hey, follow them. Follow them that are spiritual. Follow those that walk in the Spirit. Follow them. Do what they do is a good admonition. But it's not about what you do that makes you acceptable with God. You know, if you're wondering, you ask the Lord. He might point out to you, well, do what she does. That's a good way to go. Fine. But I don't want to fall into the temptation of going around trying to fix everybody's problems with the prescriptions of my mind. Because it isn't going to work. It's just not. But if I preach the Word of God, by the Spirit, it's going to have an effect on people. That's what we need to do. Anyway, I spent a lot of time on that, but you get the picture, right? I think everybody can follow what he's saying. Consider yourself, lest you be tempted to do the same thing that they're doing. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ, to love one another. Love one another. If a man think himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. remember early on over here, he said, I want to find it here. Where is it? Remember, he said that they do it for themselves. Father, help me. Somewhere in here. 417. I wasn't back far enough. They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that you might affect them. Remember that one? Okay. Then he says over here, if a man... bear you one another's burdens. If a man think himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. Let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. We get excited by getting people to follow us and do what we do and follow our way. That is wrong motives. That's not what we want. I don't want a following that follows me. Because I'm something. What I want to zealously affect people in is to follow Jesus and yield to the Holy Ghost. And too much of follow me has even been in the church. Because I'm the personality you need to follow. Because I'm uplifted in your sight as some person to emulate. No. Jesus is. That's who we emulate, right? So he's telling them here, let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone. Rejoice in all that God does through you and in you. Rejoice in it. Don't rejoice in another. Rejoice in what God does in them. They can rejoice in what God does in them. For every man shall bear his own burden. Everyone. When you stand before Jesus, you're going to stand there with who? With Jesus. We're not in doubt of you. We don't want to be in doubt. You're going to stand there with Jesus. But if you're not in Jesus, guess who you stand there with? Yourself. And God accepts no man's person. None. Who does he accept? Jesus. So if I'm in Jesus and he's in me, I can stand there with Jesus. I'm acceptable. If I stand there in me, Lord, look what I've done. Lord, did I not do all these mighty things in your name? Look what I did. Look what I did. I did all these things. He says, depart from me, you that work iniquity. I never knew you. That's intense. I won't be that one. Okay. Verse 6, let him that is taught in the world communicate unto him that teaches in all good things. Because there's some teaching that goes on, but that teaching better be the Holy Ghost, right? Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. For he that sows to his flesh shall the flesh reap corruption, but he that sows to the Spirit shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. You see how large a letter I've written unto you with mine own hand. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. What's he talking about? He says, the thing is they don't want to be persecuted. That's why Peter separated himself from the Gentiles when he was in Antioch, because he just didn't want to deal with the persecution. So he just separated himself. And Paul had to get in his face over it. Say, no. You're going to suffer some persecution, suffer it. But walk uprightly. People want to avoid persecution. It's a problem. None of us likes the idea of persecution when we think of it in an earthly sense. But what does the Bible tell us to do? What's the Scripture tell us to do? Rejoice. Be exceeding glad. We see example in Acts of the disciples. Lord, we've been counted worthy to suffer for your name. They're so excited. They're rejoicing. That's walking in the Spirit. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised that they can glory in your flesh. They desire to make you followers of them, that they may glory in the number of people following them. That's really what's going on. But God forbid that I would glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision avails anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. As many walk, and as many walk, and as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. So Paul concludes his letter to the Galatians, in which he has spent the entire time pleading with them that they would not be affected wrongly by those that came and taught them to be perfected by things that they did for themselves. That is not what you hear here. It's not. People may think that's what they hear. It's not what they hear. People who get mad or sad may claim that's what they heard, but it's not what they hear. What they hear is the Word of God being preached. And the reason it cuts so deep is because the Holy Ghost is talking to you. But the pastor isn't looking at you going, I know what's going on with you. Let me say a few words that will help you. He doesn't want to do that. He wants to speak the Word of God by the Spirit that's going to help you. Because he loves. Why is he loved? Because God gave him the love, right? Same way here. Because we love you. We want to preach the word. We want to give the letter. We want you to see the whole. So that when a scripture is pulled out, you understand now the context of it all. You get what's going on here. Paul is very seriously concerned that those who he had brought and birthed and travailed to see come into the kingdom had now been removed and were cursed because they were going to go and follow these people that taught them they had to keep the law. And so he gets on them, just pounding them with this and showing them by allegories and by stories and by proofs and explanations of the word from the Old Testament, as we call it, how it made very clear that everybody under the law was under sin, concluded that everybody was under sin, that you might understand that the righteousness in Christ Jesus was the one that was given by promise to Abraham. But it was given long before that because it was given to Adam and Eve as a promise, that the seed of the woman come and bruise the head of the serpent. This promise was not new. It was just brought down to Abraham. Abraham, that seed that I promised then is coming through you. Anybody know who it was promised to after Abraham? Isaac. Who was it promised to after Isaac? He had a couple of sons. Jacob. Who was the seed promised to after Jacob? Judah. And Judah all the way down to David, son of Jesse. And it was going to be the seed of David. And from David down through the line unto Mary. Unto her, the woman through whom the seed came. Blessed above all women was she. That's amazing. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I pray that by the Spirit the word sinks deep and cuts deep and shows each one of us how to call upon you to receive in great joy and great rejoicing those things that you have done for us. Father, that you've given unto us by the Spirit, by Christ Jesus, newness of life that we can walk in. Father, each and every one of us that's come out here on a Tuesday night, Lord, to hear the word, Lord, just so hungry for you, Lord, that it would just work in us that which you prescribed for the word to do, and that every word that's unlike you would be fallen from their ears, that they would hear the word that you preach, the word that you've spoken, that their lives would be changed. Lord, that we would all recognize the revelation of Christ Jesus to each one of us. In Jesus' name.